Okay, so assalamu alaikum everyone. As I mentioned in the last lecture, we had a bit of a problem that the recording was not done. So I'm going to very briefly go over the last lecture and I'll stop and explain if there are any specific questions. Otherwise, I'm going to go over it very briefly so that we can continue on with today's lecture. So in the last lecture, we spoke about local search. And essentially, we finished local search and we spoke about hill climbing, simulated annealing, genetic algorithms, and we also spoke about a continuous space, all right, where the state space is not discrete, but is continuous. And I'll touch a little bit more upon that today. And then we'll go on to today's topic, which is adversarial search. Okay, and this is basically where you have a multi-agent scenario, where up till now we've been talking about a single agent, but now in adversarial search, you will have two adversaries, okay? Two agents playing against each other. So all your games, your starting from tic-tac-toe, chess, and go on, all of those are basically games where you have two agents. And then you could possibly have multi-agents as well. In other words, more than two agents as well, okay? Two agent is also multi-agent, yes. Anything more than one is counts as multi-agent, okay? So, yes, so the agent is actually your computer and is trying to figure out the best possible moves against you, okay? So we'll take a little bit of a look at that again today, but examples of combinatorial optimizations, which were examples of local search, we looked at the traveling salesman problem, the knapsack problem. I won't go into the details of each one of these, but the traveling salesman problem is a well-established routing algorithm in which you're basically trying to find the minimum path between traveling between a number of cities. You have to start from an origin, traverse each and every one of the cities, not missing any one of them, and come back to the origin, okay? And the question is, what is the optimal path? And optimality can be defined in many ways. It could be the cost, it could be the time, and so on, okay? And we looked at how this can be solved using different techniques. And if you did an exhaustive technique, it would be, it would be an exponential solution. It would require something like n factorial, which is exponential. But if you used other techniques, you could actually get better algorithms. And one of the algorithms that we spoke about was the first one which we spoke about was called simulated annealing, okay? And in simulated annealing, basically what you do is you start off at a particular point, and if you think that you are at a local minimum, because this was one of the problems that we saw in the eight queens problem, that you could, in a local search, you could very easily get stuck at a local minimum or local maximum, depending on what you're trying to achieve, okay? And if you get stuck in a local minimum, the question was, how do you get out of it? And we saw that problem repeatedly. And what simulated annealing does, as happens in metallurgy, is that in order to get the best crystal structure of your metal, you sort of heat it up, okay? Go to different temperatures. And then with the hope that by going to a worse state, you'll actually go down and cool down to a better future state. So this is an example over here where you're actually going to a worse state in the middle, okay? And you're taking random steps. And you're looking at different options, and then you decide based on what the objective function is of that neighbor. You decide to pick one of those, and once you pick those, you hope that it'll get you to a solution which is perhaps closer to the global minimum. Okay, it could be the global minimum, or it could be closer to that. Okay, so this was an example of where you're stuck in a bad situation. All your neighbors are worse than where you are. And in order to get better, you actually have to take a worse step. So you're going in the wrong direction for a while with the assumption that hopefully it will take you to the right direction. And here the idea was that you'd initially take bigger risks and go further away in the wrong direction. But as over time progresses, eventually you'll stop taking as many risks and you won't go as far away after a while. So over time, you sort of try to converge to a particular solution instead of keep randomly looking all over the place, okay? And then we spoke about evolutionary algorithms, which was the way perhaps, real life progresses. And here, basically, the idea was that instead of in all of these cases of in all of these cases that we spoke about, which are the combinatorial optimization problems, you don't necessarily have a starting point and an end goal. So what you do is, and you have a very large state space. So what you do is you start off randomly in some cases, and you try to achieve the optimal, you try to find the optimal minimum. The path itself is not required. You don't need to keep, you don't need to save the path. You just need to get to a solution which is perhaps the closest to the optimal, okay? And so instead of using heuristics over here, we're going to be using objective functions, okay? And the objective functions are sort of how close you are to the actual optimum, okay? So in this case, in the evolutionary algorithms, as we saw in the case of the 8-queen example, you have several situations. You start off with an initial population, okay? And this population could be large. For example, as I said, you could have, let's say, 10 parents selected out of maybe thousands, some number. And then you select your parents. So those individuals, some pairs of individuals are selected based on what your optimization function, okay? So you look at it and you try to find some function, which is in this particular case, actually it's referred to as a fitness function in evolutionary algorithms. And so you evaluate the fitness function over the population, and among the parents that you've initially selected, you select a subset of those based on the fitness function. Okay, so you start off, let's say, with 10 parents, you might reduce it to, let's say, 4 parents, okay? And then based on those parents that you've selected, you choose partners and they have crossover to be able to generate new offspring, okay? How that crossover is done was explained earlier. You also have defined your state in this case. So for example, in the 8-queen case, you define the state to be as follows. So if you have the number 3 over here, it implies that the first state has the queen in the third square. Okay, so here again, the problem is that you're trying to find a solution in which 8 queens are on the chessboard and none of them are challenging each other. Okay, so that's the problem. And of course, this could become bigger and bigger. You could have 8 queen or 16 queen or, you know, or 25 queen or any square of n, okay? And as the problem becomes larger and larger, it becomes extremely complex, as happens in all NP-hard problems, okay? So first of all, you need to identify how to actually identify a state. So this is the mechanism that we're using to identify a state. Now we've taken a bunch of parents randomly, completely randomly, okay? And then we determine their fitness function, okay? So here, I'm not showing you how it's calculated, but if you do the math, if you actually sit on the chessboard and try to figure out how many of these queens are actually not challenging each other, which is a fitness function, so you're trying to maximize that. So here, for example, in this case, you have perhaps 23 pairs, which are non-attacking pairs, okay? So the more non-attacking pairs you have, the better the fitness function, because you're trying to have all of them being non-attacking. And in this case, you can imagine that if you have 8 queens, the maximum number of non-attacking pairs would be 8 times 7 divided by 2, because a pair will be divided by 2. Okay, so the maximum that you can have is 28. So this represents perhaps a better solution. We randomly picked it up, but it represents a better fitness function. This represents a really poor fitness function, okay? So when we're selecting the parents, we only select perhaps the better ones. So in this case, in this example, in the example given in the book, they've only selected 3 parents. You would have expected an even number, but here they've selected 3 pairs, 3 total. And then they have the crossover process. The crossover is fairly straightforward. You randomly decide at a point where you're going to differentiate between the left and the right side. And so the crossover is performed by selecting, in this case, 3 to 7 to come over here, and 4, 8, 5, 5, 2 to combine over here to form the first offspring, G. if you could place queens diagonally, in other words, you're saying that, let's say that these two queens, if you placed a queen over here, and these were two queens, and they were allowed, you're saying? No, you can't place them. So the requirement is that they you know how to play chess, right? So in chess, if two queens are actually diagonally, facing each other, they can actually kill each other, right? So no diagonals are allowed. No verticals, no horizontals, no diagonals, okay? So so you decide, so every parents, pair of parents will actually give you two offsprings. Here's an example of one offspring. Okay, you can figure that out. Once that is done, the next stage is to mutate the offspring, okay? And so randomly, some of those offspring will have individual states being slightly modified, not completely modified. In this 8-queen example, you know, one of those digits is changed, okay? So instead of having 5-5-2, you have this digit is changed into a 1, okay? Here you can see that the digit 7 is converted into a 2 and so on, okay? So you have these random mutations. After you've done with the mutations, you basically have a set of offspring, and among those offspring, you again use the fitness function to evaluate them, okay? So going back to our overall algorithm, you've got your offspring, and then you select the best offspring, okay, to form the next population. So some of those offspring will have really bad fitness functions, they'll be let go, and the best among them will be selected. In this evolutionary algorithm or genetic algorithm, as it is specifically called, you have a termination state. In other words, you decide when you're good enough, you're close enough. So your termination state may be that you're trying to find an optimal value of 28, but maybe anything above 25 may be good enough for you, okay? So you might say, well, if I get 25, I'm going to stop. Or you're more ambitious and you say, I'm going to stop at 27, okay? Or you might say, I'm just going to stop at 28. So you have a termination function, and that's how this game will proceed. This will keep on going on and on until you actually terminate the game, okay? Or, you know, your time is up or what have you. So that is a very quick overview of genetic algorithms. And next, what we discussed was where can you apply it? So we said that you can't apply it to every algorithm, okay? So you can't apply it to the 8 puzzle. You can't, simply because that has a starting goal and has a starting point and has an end goal, okay? So you can't just randomly start somewhere. So in those kind of problems, similarly chess, you can't really use this. But in a traveling salesman problem or other combinatorial optimization problems where you don't necessarily have a starting point, specific starting point, but you have something which is identified as a goal, there you can use the evolutionary algorithm, okay? So you can apply it to the TSP, but you can't really apply it to the 8 puzzle, even though I've shown it, but that's not an ideal demonstration. The next part we covered was what happens when we say that the state space is no longer discrete, okay? And as I mentioned, this happens a lot in real life, in a lot of the machine learning algorithms, okay? And you'll see a lot of these applications later on as we study machine learning. So in this case, basically X over here is representing the state space, but it's not discrete, okay? It's a real number, it's continuous. And so the question was, how do you actually find the optimal value? Okay, and then we went over the details of this. We could have, for example, a function, okay? And this you might have studied in calculus and so on as well. One of the simple techniques is that you take the differential and you make the derivative equal to zero. But if you don't have a closed form solution for f of x, then what do? You have an iterative method, okay? So let's take a look at the iterative method. It basically says that you use the previous value. So for example, you started off randomly with a number 11, okay? You don't really know that the optimal value is at 25. That's supposed to be at 25, okay? So you start off with x of n, and you don't even know the shape of this curve. So you're trying to find whether you should go right or left, okay? And then we spoke about this last time, that if you take the derivative of this, the sign of the derivative will tell you that which direction you have to go. Okay, so if the derivative, for example, the gradient is a negative number, then clearly you have to go in the forward direction. If the gradient is a positive number, you have to go in the negative direction. Okay, so that's why we have a negative sign over here. So we'll take the previous values. So let's do this. So let's start with xn is equal to 11. It's picked out of a hat. We find the derivative. How do you find the derivative? If you don't have a closed form solution, you think you can refer to your calculus notes, but you can take a small step in either direction, and delta y upon delta x will give you the derivative. Okay, so you find this out. Let's say that it comes out to be negative 2. Okay, so what you do is you use this equation and you get 11 minus, and then we have a learning rate. And we spoke about what happens if the learning rate is very large or very small. So if the learning rate is very small, then it'll take you forever to converge. Okay, if the learning rate is too large, then you may actually diverge. So in this case, you start with some number. Hopefully it's not too big, it's not too small. And let's say that you go over this and you have 11 minus, and we are going to assume that the learning rate here is 1. So this is 1 over here. And then the derivative is minus 2. So we end up with 11 plus 2, which is 13. Okay. And so we jump to the next point, which is 13. Right. Then we find the derivative again over here. So this line over here represents the slope. It'll probably be less than minus 2. Okay, because as you can see, we're getting flatter and flatter. So this is going to be, let's say, minus 1. Okay, so the slope over here is minus 1. The next value is going to be 13. And the learning rate is still 1. And you choose minus 1. You found out minus 1 as your slope. And so the next value comes out to be 13 plus 1, which is 14. Now notice that you're taking smaller steps. Why? Because the slope is becoming smaller. Okay, so you're sort of slowly getting closer and closer to the destination, and so on. So this, the next just actually shows you, you're going to go to 13, and maybe the next slope is even smaller, 0.5, and so on. So slowly you'll be getting closer and closer to 25. Okay, so that's a very famous algorithm, which is called gradient descent. And if you study deep learning or machine learning, this will come in over and over again. This is one of the standard techniques of actually finding the optimal point in any scenario. Okay, but of course, it still does have the issue of getting stuck in a local minimum and local maximum. That is not addressed here. There are other techniques which I'm not going to go into. Those are referred to as momentum based and so on. And what they try to do is overcome the local minimum or local maximum problem, but we're not talking about that today. And an example of where this is used again. So let me just talk a little bit about, remember in the first or second lecture, we spoke about neural networks. Okay. So in neural networks, basically what you have is a bunch of inputs. Okay. And you have a bunch of neurons, and these are used to calculate the output. Okay, and the output is calculated based on the weights. So each one of these edges represents, if you remember the example that I gave, the brain has synapses. Okay, and those represent how the neurons are connected. So the strength of the synapse is represented over here by weight. So let's say this is weight 1. Now the million-dollar question essentially is, what are the values of the weights? Okay, so you could come up with a very large neural network and you will know the weights. So you start off randomly and just pick completely out of the box a whole bunch of random numbers. And then the question really is, how do you actually get to the optimal weights? Okay, and here again, you have extremely difficult, extremely tough looking terrain to be able to find the optimal solution for. And what you try to do is, in this particular case, you use the gradient descent algorithm. You look at, you have labeled data. So as I said earlier, you do know where you want to get. Okay, so for example, if this represents an image and you have that this person is, yes, your friend X, and it's giving you Y, that the output that it is not your friend, then you're going to have a correction. Okay, you're going to say label minus the output is going to be your error. Now the error is going to essentially represent your objective function. Okay, so the error, if the error is large over here, then that means you need to be able to get to a better weight. Okay. If the error is small, then you're getting going in the right direction. So use that error over here. Okay. And you use gradient descent to actually improve the value of the weights. Okay. So you can just imagine if you go back over here, this could be one of the weights in the neural network, and you're trying to find the optimal value of the weight. And so you're taking the error and you're trying to use the gradient descent algorithm to actually improve the error. Okay. Now I'm going over this very fast because if I were to go into it in a lot more detail, it'll take a lot longer. And the real objective over here is to simply tell you that there are applications for this particular algorithm. Okay. Gradient descent using the state space, which is continuous. There are huge amounts of applications, a very important area. Okay. So that takes us, well, it took me longer. I was hoping it would take me shorter time to go over the last lecture, but that was basically a quick review of the previous lecture. G. Okay, so the best value of R is a very tricky question. Okay. There is no essentially best value to start with. What a lot of times you do is, in this case, if you notice that R is kept the same, right? It's one over here, it's again one over here, and it's again one over here, okay? What you have is adaptive algorithms as well, which actually modify the value of R depending on how fast or slow you want to go, okay? So for example, over here, you realize that you're very far from the destination. Initially, you might make R very large, so you get fairly close to the destination. But once you're very close, you don't want to go very far. Just like in simulated annealing, you sort of reduce the experimentation that you want to do is reduced. So you have techniques in which the value of R is actually reduced over time. Okay, and there are other techniques as well. So we'll talk about this a little bit more when we get to the portion about neural networks. Hopefully, it was the end of this course. We'll talk more about this. Okay, G. So again, as I said, this is the example that I just told you is in machine learning, where you're actually trying to use it for neural networks. Okay, so this was one of the most popular examples of using gradient descent in AI today. Okay, almost all of deep learning is based on using some form of gradient descent. Okay, and neural networks, I'm sure you have some idea about what's going on in the world of AI these days. And everything is about neural networks and deep learning simply because they give you such fantastically good results. And all of that is based around this architecture where you're modeling your AI as a neural network, which is modeled around the brain. And so you're trying to really find the optimal value of all of these weights. There are a whole bunch of weights over here. Each one of these interconnections has a certain weight, okay? And you calculate the value of the output based on the input multiplied by the weight. Okay, so every time you're calculating the output, you have to know the weight. Okay, so this is one example of where it's used. So now let's talk about today's topic, which is adversarial search. Okay, so as the term adversarial implies that you have adversaries. Okay, so now in this case, you don't have a single agent, you've got multiple agents. So let's take a look at our famous and most popular game that hopefully we've all played one point or the other in our lives, tic-tac-toe. Okay, so the game of tic-tac-toe is a multi-agent, right? Simply because now you have two people playing. Okay, and here you can see we've sort of shown the search path again as a tree, but there is a slight difference. It's not a normal tree. Now we're referring to it as a game tree. Okay, and why is that? Well, let's take a look. Let's say that you are one of the players, and let's call it Max, player Max, and the other player is Min. Why we're calling it Max and Min will become evident as you go forward, okay? And basically, you're the crosses, and Min is the knots, okay? You're the O, this is O's, and this is the crosses. So when you start up the game, and let's say the crosses have to start, Max has to start, he or she has got obviously 9 places where they can put the cross, okay? So it could be anyone over here or all the way going over here, okay? Once that is done, Min has the next chance, and Min will play one of possibly not nine, but how many? Eight, because one of them is already gone. So if this is the decision, if this is the first move, then this is fixed. And the only options that Min has is to either put their over here or here or here and so on. Okay, eight possible. So nine options here and then eight options over here and all the way until you have zero options left. Okay, so if you look at the total possible paths that exist, you can see that there'll be initially nine paths and then eight and then seven and six and so on. So essentially how many? It's 9 factorial, which is a pretty large number. I think it's about 350,000 or so, okay? So even if you try to figure out the optimal path for a simple game such as tic-tac-toe, and it has a certain predefined depth. So what's the maximum depth of this tree? In some cases, of course, your depth can go up to infinity, okay? In some cases, chess, for example, your depth can go up to hundreds, okay? In this case, it's very well defined. The maximum depth is clearly 9, okay? Because after that, you run out of spaces on the board, okay? Now, the question is, what is the optimal strategy? So one could start with a BFS or DFS, but again, those have the usual problems, okay? And then the question is, how do you actually determine what is optimal? Because now what you also have is you have a utility function, okay? So in previous scenarios, you had an optimal solution, you had a goal, but here you have multiple solutions and each one of them has a different, perhaps a different utility for you. So in this case, these games are referred to as zero-sum games, okay? Zero-sum simply means that, let's say in this case, if X wins, X gets plus one, okay? Y gets minus one, all right? If X wins, then X gets plus one, Y gets a minus one. And if you look at the sum of both of those utilities, it's actually zero, okay? If Y wins, then Y gets plus one, X gets minus one, and again, the sum is zero. If there's a draw, both of them get a zero, and again, the sum is zero. So what you can see is that the sum overall is always zero. So these games are referred to as zero-sum games. In other words, if one person loses X point, if one person gains X points, the other person always loses exactly the same amount of points, okay? So these are referred to as zero-sum games. Can you think of a game which is another game which is zero-sum and perhaps another game which is not zero-sum? Ludo, okay. So any game like Ludo or any board game, typically, do you think that's a zero-sum game? If even if you think about chess, a favorite example, either one person wins and the other person loses, or there's a draw, just like over here. So it's a zero-sum because the person who's winning, let's say, gets a plus, and the person who's losing gets a negative, and if you have a draw, it's zero. So it's always zero-sum. Sure. The question is,
In Ludo, there isn't any option of draw, right?
Say that again.
Ludo mein draw ka option nahi hota na?
Ludo mein draw ka option nahi hota. Okay. So essentially that doesn't have this. But even then, is it a zero-sum game? One person will, of course, win. And let's say you're defining the utility of winning as plus one. And one person will lose. That will be minus one. So the sum will always be zero. Okay, plus one, minus one comes out to be zero. In that case, you don't have a draw, you only have these two situations. In both of these, you actually have the overall sum, the net utility comes out to be zero. Okay, I'm forgetting how Ludo is actually played. It's been ages, honestly, since I last played. Okay, so remind me how Ludo plays. You've got how many? Four players. Okay, and how does the game go again? You have, it's like snakes and ladders? You have dice, okay. I'll have to learn those games again. But think of a simpler example. But is there a question about Ludo which is unanswered over here? Ji. Usko equal points de sakte. So let's say if you're playing a game in which there are four players, okay, and you are not defining in the utility in such a way that the sum is always zero. You could define it in such a way, but let's say you're not defining it in such a way. So let's say that first player one, two, and three, four. Let's say there are four players. The fourth player comes out fourth, the first player comes out first, right? Let's assume this is a game, okay? And now suppose I say that this person gets four, three, two, and one. Now my question is that, let's assume that in a game, everybody is ordered. Everybody will either be first or second or third or fourth, okay? Two people can't be first. So the question is, will this game always be a zero sum game? Well, it's not summing to zero because the way we've chosen the utilization is not summing up to zero, but is it summing up to a constant number? Okay, so it is adding up to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, so you can imagine that another game in which it is completely opposite, it's 4, 3, 2, 1. So again, it will add up to 10. So all of these games can be thought of as zero sum. Why? Because eventually one person's gain is another person's loss. Okay, now think of a game which is not zero sum. Gee, Monopoly. Okay, so yeah, so in Monopoly, you get different rewards. Okay, think about something which is real life. Gee. Okay, so give me another example. Yeah, sorry. Okay, so you can imagine, you can come up with tons of examples where whenever the sum of all the utilizations is not summing up to the same number, okay, that would not be a zero-sum game. A more real-life example is, let's say you're going on the street, okay, and a beggar comes up to you and you start having a fight with the beggar, okay, right? Now, if he wins, does he gain as much as you lose? Or do you lose more? Okay, you're an IBA graduate. Do you have more to lose than the person on the street, the beggar, right? Hopefully, yes. You have a lot more, you have a reputation to lose. Somebody puts the fight on YouTube, and next thing you know, your reputation is gone. So that's an example where it's not a zero-sum game. You have a lot more to lose than the other person, okay? So you can think of different scenarios where it is not always zero sum, but the examples that we're going to take over here today are going to be zero sum. One person's gain is going to be exactly equal to the other person's loss. G. Sorry, the KU incident, I don't know the details of that. I don't want to know, okay? I've got out of administration and I'm happy with that, okay? So let's take a look at this particular game. Okay, so this is referred to as a two-ply. Now, ply is another term for the depth, okay? Just another term, because depth is not used over here, it's just another term. So here, two-ply, because it implies that if you think about the tic-tac-toe, how many plies was that? What is the maximum depth? It was a 9-ply game, okay? So this is a two-ply game, which is, it's a fictitious game. It's just to show you the different options. Let's assume that this is zero sum, and in zero sum, we don't actually need to know what is the value that Y is getting because it's simply going to be the opposite, okay? So let's assume that the values that X is getting is $10, $1, $2, $3, and Y is getting, and the total value that you're going to give off is 10. So if you're ending up with one, with X is getting up as one, then Y is getting 9. Okay, so Y wants to minimize X's value, and X obviously wants to maximize its own value. Okay, so I'm shown over here is the values that X may be getting. I haven't told you how. Let's assume that there are only four solutions. Okay, and each one of them has a certain value or utility for X. Okay, so I hope the game is clear. Now the question is, and it starts off with player X over here. So these diamonds pointing upwards, pyramids are A's play, A's move, and these inverted pyramids those were X's move, and the inverted pyramids are Y's moves, okay? So now the question here is, and X initially starts off, okay, he's won the toss somehow, and he has to decide between one of possible two moves. Either he can make move A1 or can move A2, okay? Now, if you look at this, the possible payoffs for X, in which direction that is, does it seem like X would want to go? Okay, G. Yeah. So first, the question is, what is the first move that X will choose, given that you know that these are your utilizations, these are four possible end games, okay? And in one, you're going to get $10, the other, you're going to get $1, in this one, you're going to get $2, here, you're going to get $3. So, okay, so you're getting the idea. Basically, you're going to sort of play something called a mini-max game, okay? But let's, before we get to that, let's just take a look at the intuition. How many of you think that you should go in this direction? Because there's a $10 payoff over here. A few of you, okay? Quite a few of you, all right? Now, let's assume that you do make this choice, okay? You take this move, A2, you end up over here. Now, this is a simple game in which X first made a move, and now it's Y's turn, okay? Now, Y will look at, and they have complete information about all the solutions. So Y will look at these two. What is Y going to decide between D1 and D2? Sorry, that should have been a C1 and C2. But anyway, what is Y going to decide at this particular point? It's naturally going to decide, let's call this C1 and C2, okay? So Y is going to choose move C1. Why is that? Because naturally this is a better choice for Y, and this is better choice for X. So what have you done? By choosing move A2, you were hoping that you would end up with a 10 payoff, but actually there was a player Y which actually obstructed your path to the solution. All right, so somebody else is now actually playing against you, and it's not a simple tree search where you were in complete control. Now somebody else is actually in control half the time, okay? And they actually thwart your moves. So this person actually gets you into your least possible solution, which was getting a one. Now, obviously, it seems like this seems to be a better move, okay? So if you choose A1 as your first move, what will player Y choose? It will choose two. Why is that? Because two is a lower value for X as compared to three, okay? So essentially, if you look at it, what you're trying to do is you're trying to maximize your reward, and B and Y, your opponent, is actually trying to minimize your reward. Not their own reward, they're trying to maximize their own reward, but they're trying to minimize your reward. And since we're only looking at X's rewards over here, this is sort of considered this person is trying to maximize the reward, and this person is trying to minimize the reward. Okay, so it's a fairly simple, straightforward case, okay? However, we haven't tried to figure out how, in this particular case, you could actually look at all the possible options and figure out what the solution is. And the solution is, of course, the optimal strategy is using where I've shown the three arrows, okay? A should choose A1, and X will choose A1, and then Y will choose B2, okay? And you'll end up with this final solution, in which X does not have 10, but at least it does not have one, okay? So it's perhaps as best as X could actually get. G, this question, G. So these are the possible payoffs, all right? So X could have gotten 10, but as you know, it's not possible for X to get 10 because Y will simply choose this path. And so X actually chose this path over here, and then Y tried to maximize its own value, minimize yours, and so it chose B2. Okay. Sorry? Yes, in this case, Y will actually get 8. So actually, Y will get better payoff, but the game was designed in such a way that, you know, X couldn't have actually gotten better than 2 in this case. Okay. Now, one of the assumptions we made about Y is that Y will obviously always work in its own interest, okay? It's not stochastic, it's not random. it knows exactly what's it's in its best interest. Okay, so this is one of the assumptions over here, and we'll relax this as we go forward. Okay, now let's take a slide. So this was the solution. Now let's take a slightly more complex game in which what we've done is we've got three choices. Okay, and if you're thinking about where would you have three choices, well, you can imagine where, you know, you can come up with a game where you have three choices. So let's try to, and we're going to replace this with max and min, and let's try to see how we can actually solve it. Okay, how would you go about trying to solve it? Well, how would player X, starting over here, choose its best strategy? G. Tell me step by step. So let's look at this. This is an actual problem, okay? These are the values that X will get. These are the utilities values for player X. -3, -5, -10, -1, -0, -2, 0, 1, 2. Now what are you going to do? How do you solve it? Third choice, A3. You think that's the best? No, so the game is terminating over here. It's a 2-ply game, okay? It's not going beyond this. The depth is 2. There's only X will have one choice, and then Y will have a X will have one move, then Y will have move. That's it. That game ends. G. Yes. Yes. Okay, very good. So you've actually solved the problem. You basically said that it knows that Y will choose the best possible, the worst possible situation for X. And so it will find out what is the worst possible situation in these scenarios, right? That's what you're saying. So let's say we look at this and we say, well, in this scenario, B will choose -3, right? Because that will be the worst possible situation for X. In this case, it will choose -1. In this case, it will choose 0, okay? Now X has to choose between -3, -1, and 0. So it'll try to maximize its value. What will it choose? It'll choose 0. So it seemed like, you know, if you didn't do this calculation, it seemed like, hey, wait a second, I'm getting 10 over here, $10 here. I should try to go in the direction of A1, but you hadn't thought it through. Okay. If you had thought it through, you'd have clearly said the best thing I can do is get a 0. Okay. So this was maybe an example of zero sum where it's a draw, okay? So neither one of them is winning. So these values that I showed you over here, these are what are referred to as mini max values, okay? And if you notice how the game is proceeding, do you think it's going forward or it's going backwards? It seems like it's going backwards, right? You're going to the leaf nodes, you're going all the way till the end and you're sort of backtracking, okay? And you're working upwards. So it's not going forward, you're going at the end and you're sort of backtracking towards the solution, okay? You saw that earlier. Let's take another example perhaps, okay? So here is a 3-ply game. So in this case, you have maximum, you have now we're just going to call the players max, min, okay? So this is player max, this is player min, this is player max. Now, this is not a very fair game. Why? Because Max has got two chances, two moves, and Y unfortunately has only one. Okay, but this is just for illustration. Okay, so here, how are we going to do it? So help me out with this. How are we going to choose the minimax values? So we can start anywhere. We can start from the right, we can start from the left, we can start from the middle, but let's start from the left. Okay, so what's the minimax value over here? Sorry? Somebody's saying minus 12 and somebody's saying 10. What is it? It's going to be max value. Why? Because it's actually the max they're staying over here. So it's not going to be 12. It's going to be 10. He's going to pick the maximum value. What is it going to be here? 7, 3, 2, 2, 1. Okay. So you've got the minimax values at this layer. Now we come back over here. What is the minimax value here? 7. Why? Because this is going to minimize the two options. Here, what is it? 2, 1. Okay. So now for A, what is the minimax value? 7. Right? So the optimal solution is this particular path. Okay. Sorry? Why is it the optimal solution? Okay, so basically what we've said is that if you think about going backwards, if you had ended up in any one of these solutions, the maximum value that the max player could have gotten is 10 over here, right? And so, to be able to get to this layer, there's this opponent, right? Unfortunately. So it's not a simple tree search. There's somebody who's actually, you know, fighting with you. He's trying to put you down. You imagine you wrestling with somebody and you make a move on this side and the person, you know, throws you on your back. Okay. So this guy over here is trying to minimize your value. So he's not going to let you get to 10. Okay. He's going to let you only get to 7 between these two choices. If you come over here, then he's only going to let you get to 2. Okay. Because he's trying to minimize yours. So in this case, he would choose 1. All right. So because you have a min play in the middle, the best that you can do is either 7, 2, or 1. Okay. Between all of these choices, your choices are actually narrowed down because of the min player. And the min player has now actually reduced your choices to 7, 2, and 1. Now between 7, 2, and 1, which is the best? Naturally, that would be the best. So in other words, if you think through it, all you're doing is you're saying, I'm going to go in this direction. And because I know that I'm going to get a 7 payoff, why am I going to get a 7? Because I know that B is going to be my worst enemy and is going to choose not 10, not a friend of mine, but an enemy. So he's going to choose 7. Okay. So I'm going to end up in this particular state. Okay. So this is the best optimal strategy for A to take over here. Okay. So hope that's clear. Okay. The assumptions are that Y will always, the min player will always choose the worst for you. Okay, that's an assumption. And whenever the person plays, does get their way around. Okay, it's not a stochastic or probabilistic game. Okay, now you can imagine that the game that I showed you above had 3 choices initially, okay, and then 2, and then 2. All right. And you might be wondering, wait a second, don't you always have the same number of choices or so on? Well, clearly that's not always true. We've already seen that initially you had 9 and then 8 and then 7. Here's another example of tic-tac-toe where you have 3 choices initially and then 2 and then 1. So you could have different types of games, okay? The number of branches will depend on the specific game, okay? Now, let's take a look at, and this was the solution that I already worked out. G. Yes, so this, there is a certain assumption when I show you this game tree, the assumption is that Max is playing first. Okay, Max is somehow won the toss maybe and it's playing first. Okay, and then it's a very odd game. It only has 3 plies. Normally you would at least let both the games have, you know, equal number of turns. Okay, so it's just a fictitious game just to show you the methodology. Okay, and we'll get to some other examples. So let's take a look at the first example, but now I've made it stochastic. Okay, I've made it probabilistic. In other words, what I'm saying is that Y is not very smart. Okay, maybe has a blindfold. Is going to completely randomly choose a solution. Okay. Now, can you tell me which will be the best move for A? Sorry? A2. Why do you think that? Can you tell me why? Aap bataiye ji. It has a probability of what? Sorry? Yeah, so it has an equal, once it's come over here, it has got a 50-50 chance. So it's got a 50% chance of going in either direction, okay? So, and here you also had a 50% chance of going, and your intuition tells you that, you know, if you have 50% chance, you're probably going to, the expected value over here is probably 2.5, and the expected value over here is somewhere between 1 and 10, which is probably 5.5, okay? And this expected value over here seems to be much higher than the expected value on the left side. So you'll probably choose A2 as you move. Okay. But G. So is it, yes, so there is a risk. So the question is, what kind of a player are you? Okay, and that's a very good, very important question, that what kind of a player are you, and what are you trying to, you know, what are you betting against, what are you hedging against, and so on. And that makes you a more complex player. So suppose that you were a safe player, okay, and you wanted to get, you know, this is let's say $2,000 or $200,000 that you're getting, right? So let's multiply all of these by $100K, okay? And you're a parent, and you're trying to fund your child, your only child, to go to Harvard, right? He's got admission, but you don't have the funds. And the amount that you need to get to Harvard is $200,000. Now, which path will you take? Now you'll take A1. Why is that? Because now you're more secure. Because you know that in this particular case, you're definitely going to get a $200,000 reward. Okay? And any of you have seen that movie? That's a very interesting movie. I'm forgetting the name of the movie. It's actually, I'm drawing this example from there. Okay? It's very interesting. I'll give you the link later on. It's actually about a group of students at MIT who place bets. I think it's called Huntington something, or no, it's the other one. Anyway, so a great movie. I'd recommend you that you watch it regardless. So here you're basically saying that you would want to play safe, and you'd want to go for this simply because you don't want to risk getting $100,000, in which case you'd actually not be able to fund your son, okay, or your child or your daughter. So it depends on what you're trying to do. Now, in most cases, if you don't have that particular dilemma, what would you try to maximize? Would you go with this, or would you go with what the other gentleman hypothetically stated? You'd probably go with this scenario, right? Why is that? Because the... If you can put it in a simple terms, because your expected value is higher, okay? And if you studied stochastic probability, then you know what expected value means, right? How do you calculate your expected value? So what are we basically doing? How did you calculate 5.5 or 2.5? We basically said this is the payoff 3, but it has a probability of 0.5. So you weight your payoff by the probability of it's happening, okay? And then you say, well, I could also get 2, but again, the probability is 0.5. So you get 1.5 plus 1, which will give you 2.5, all right? So this is how you're calculating your expected value. So your expected reward over here, you won't actually get 2.5. You'll either get a 2 or a 3, but on average, if you played this a large number of times, on average, you will get 2.5. Okay. Similarly, over here, on average, you will get 5.5. Now, let's make it a little bit more tricky. So this was the solution for that problem. But let's make it a little bit more tricky and say that, assume that Y picks the wrong answer 10% of the time. Now, it's not so obvious. Okay. And I'm assuming that you're trying to maximize your expected value. Okay. And you're not that parent of a Harvard parent. Okay. So now, how do you calculate your expected value? Can somebody help me with this? On the left side, what's your expected value? So the now Y is going to pick a wrong move. Which is the right move here for Y? This is the right move. So this is going to be chosen 90% of the time. This is going to be chosen 10% of the time, right? So your expected value is what? 3 times 0.1 plus 2 times 0.9, right? You can calculate this. Similarly, you're going to calculate the expected value over here, which will be the right value will be 0.9, and this will be 0.1, right? Because this guy is going to try to get you over here, okay? There's only a 10% chance that you'll actually get that $10 value, okay? So if you do the calculations, I'm not doing it over here, but you'll see that the expected value over here is 2.1, and the expected value over here is 1.9. So what are you going to do is you're going to choose the A1 path. Okay, so you can see how the expected value comes in when you have stochastic, you have probabilistic scenarios. Okay. Why was 2 with 0.9? Because we're saying that y picks the wrong value 10% of the time. 90% of that at the time it's got its cards in order, you know, it's making the right decision. But 10% of the time it kind of gets confused, you know, and chooses the wrong answer. Now it's obvious that 2 is smaller than 3, so 90% of the time it's going to choose this. But once in a while, it confuses the two numbers and it chooses the wrong answer. Okay. So here, the expected values will actually determine which path you take. Okay. So this can be demonstrated in different ways. In the book, you'll see it shown as here, as the following. Okay. So basically, it's shown as chance being a third player. Okay. So you can think of chance. Actually, in this case, I haven't shown it as a third player, but you could think of chance itself as a third player. So you actually now have a three-player game, okay? So you have Max, and then in the middle you have Mr. Chance, and then you have Minnow, okay? So Chance will either choose this 90% of the time, this is a different problem, or choose this 10% of the time, okay? And so you can look at the whole game in this manner as well. I'm not gonna go into the details of this. This is simply showing you an alternate method. And you'll see that in the book, it shows you, you know, the best moves. For example, over here, this is a very famous game that is often, just like chess has been thoroughly analyzed by AI people. Similarly, backgammon is one of those games in which you have two players, and it's a stochastic game, okay? So I don't know, is anybody familiar with backgammon? Probably not. So in backgammon, basically you have two players, but then before each person actually plays their move, they actually throw a couple of dice, okay? And then depending on the value of the dice, that restricts what moves they can make, okay? Sort of like Ludo and so on, okay? I think Ludo would also come in this category because you're throwing a dice and then depending on the value, you can have certain number of moves, okay? So similar to that. But it's much more complex and interesting for people in the AI research community. Okay. Now let's think of another scenario, the same scenario now. And now you think of, you actually have three players. Okay. So imagine now you have the Ludo game, but a slightly modification of it, and you have only three players. Now each one of those three players is independent. Okay. You can think of it as three political parties in Pakistan, right? So you've got PTI and you've got the People's Party and you've got the third party, all right? And they're all trying to, you know, become, you know, the leaders for the next generation. So now what is each one of them going to do? And how do you actually play this game? And now, is it simply, well, first of all, can it be considered as a minimax game, as a zero-sum game? It can or cannot be, okay? It depends on actually what values each one of them is getting at the terminal values, okay? So depending on the actual game, it could be a zero-sum game or not, okay? But the main question I'm asking you over here is that how do you actually identify the final state? So let's say this is, how many plies is this? 3-ply, okay? So this is a 3-ply game and it's going to end at the 3rd ply. So the question is, how do you actually identify the winning values? Okay, now earlier we were only using X's value because the other guy was zero sum and the other was simply the what is left over. But in this case, there are three players. So how do we identify the final states? Do we simply identify X's winning value? No, we can't just end with that. So would we actually have to specify not X over here, but here this is A, B, and C. So here we need to not only identify A's winning value, but also B's, okay? We also need to identify C's value. It depends. If it's a zero sum, we may not have to identify C, but if it's not, we need to identify C's value as well, Okay, so let's take a look at this game. And this is actually given in the book. So this is figure 5.4 from the book. So here basically you have 1, 2, 6, 4, 2, 3. These are the different terminal states, okay? And let's try to figure out, is it a zero-sum game or not? So the total sum over here is 9, and the total sum over here is 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So is it zero-sum? Clearly not, right? Because different states, final states, have different total sums, okay? So it's not a zero-sum. Now the question is, how do you play such a game? Okay, here they've shown you some moves, but let's start from the top over here. And let's say you are A, and you know that if you play this game, you have two moves. You could either go in this direction or this direction. In both of these directions, you are getting a reward of 1, okay? So if let's forget about the whole game, where would you actually ideally want to go? Sorry? Either way, what if you were PTI and People's Party, and so what if you actually, you thought that you actually wanted to bunch up against these other people as well, okay? So I'm trying to create a more complex scenario than perhaps what is shown over here. But when you have multiplayer games, okay, then maybe you can have alliances as well. Okay, you can imagine what's going on in the situation in the country right now. There's a strong player, maybe he's already gotten there, selected player, perhaps. And the other two players are actually trying to, get that player to be put down. Okay, once that player is down, then they'll fight amongst each other and figure out what's the best strategy. But right now, they're simply trying to make A or one player being, come down. So if there's a strong player, you could imagine that two players who are weak players might want to team up together and try to make a move such that the strong player is initially defeated. Unko pata hai ki, if that player is defeated, then it's going between the two of us, and then they have their own political situation. They know how things are going to pan out after that. So bottom line here is that multiplayer games can become very sophisticated. Okay, I'm not even going to go through all of this. But they can become very sophisticated. For example, in this particular case, between these two, you may say, well, 6 plus 2 is 8, and 5 plus 2 is 7. Okay? Now think about it. Between these two, your opponents now, in this case, are getting 7, and your opponents here are getting 8. Now which move will you take? You'll probably take the right move, this direction, right? Because if you're not getting anything, at least your opponents are not getting a lot more. Okay? So you can imagine what kinds of games you can play over here, okay? Now, multiplayer becomes complex, so let's not spend too much time on that. Now, let's take a look at the properties of this algorithm, okay? So far, if you look at how we've done the minimax algorithm, was it a depth-first search algorithm or breadth-first search? Yeah. 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 So you're absolutely right. I haven't actually gone through this whole thing. Case. Okay. We can analyze it separately. But my objective here was simply to tell you that in a multiplayer game, the situation can become very complex. It depends on if there are people, if two of them are actually trying to achieve something together. Okay. They're teaming up together to have a strategy in place, okay? So that was my main point, but yes, you could analyze this game and we could probably do it offline as well, okay? I'll be interested to do it offline. But let's take a look at this. First question, is it a DFS or BFS search? Depth first, yeah? Simply because as you saw, we went all the way down and then we backtracked, okay? We didn't look at horizontally, okay? Does it provide you, if you do that search strategy, does it provide you an optimal solution? Yeah, you can try, it does take an optimal solution. Does provide you an optimal solution. What do you think is the time complexity? order of, now it's a depth first. In all of those, time complexity is what? Branching factor to the power of m, sir, right? Where m is the,
sir,
the plies.
Sir, your voice got cut off when you were talking about the optimal solution. Your voice got cut off.
When, at what stage?
On the optimal, when you were talking about the optimal.
On the optimal point. Okay. So let me just repeat that. So the question was, is it optimal? And the answer is that yes, in the sense that it will, if you do a DFS, the minimax algorithm, it will provide you the optimal solution. Okay. The time complexity you can imagine is order of b to power m. That's true in almost all of the searches that we've seen so far, the DFS and the BFS searches, okay? What is the space complexity? It's going to be order of b times m, right? Why is that? Because it's a depth first search and we're not really saving all of the breadth first options, okay? Now, so this is just to tell you that, yes, these are some of the solutions. In chess, for example, B is about 35. You have a branching factor of 35, all right? So now Deep Blue, which was actually the game that IBM used to defeat Kasparov in 1997, went down to a depth of about 6 to 16 plies. And at times, it went up to a depth of 40 plies, okay? So it's actually thinking ahead, and it's trying to backtrack from all of those positions and trying to find out what is its optimum strategy. It's not going all the way down to the, you know, the maximum depth. That becomes extremely difficult, right? Because imagine B is 35 and you're going up to 40. So the number of moves becomes pretty large, okay? So it depends on, you know, how big, you know, supercomputer you have. But again, is there a better solution? Okay, this seems to be sort of a brute force technique, right? We sort of, you know, doing an optimal search, we're going through all the possible solutions, and we're trying to find a best search, okay? So we're going to stop over here. Next time we'll try to see if this particular search can be improved or not.